inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Gloria,
Gloria.
Reading from the First Kings. Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, "So may the gods do to me, and more also, if I do not make your life like the life of one of them by this time tomorrow." Then he was afraid. He got up and fled for his life, and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah. He left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under the solitary broom tree. He asked that he might die. "It is enough now, Lord, O Lord, take away my life, for I am no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down under the broom tree and fell asleep. Suddenly, an angel touched him and said to him, "Get up and eat." He looked, and there at his head was a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. He ate and drank and lay down again. The angel of the Lord came a second time, touched him, and said, "Get up and eat, otherwise the journey will be too much for you." He got up and ate and drank. Then he went into the strength of that food for 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the Mount of God. At that place he came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take away." Then the Lord said to him, Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm, I will be delighted in your looking to the Lord, please. The heavens declare the glory of the Most High, and the firmament shows God's handiwork.
One day tells its tale to another, and one night imparts knowledge to another.
Although they have no words or language, and their voices are not heard,
their sound has gone out into all the lands, and their message to all the ends of the earth.
In the deep has God set a pavilion for the sun. It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course.
It goes forth from the uttermost edge of the heavens and runs out to the end of its hand.
The law of the Most High is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of God is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent.
The statutes of the Most High are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of God is clear and gives light to the eyes.
The fear of the Most High is clean and endures forever. The judgments of God are true and righteous altogether.
More to be fair are they than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter are than honey, and honey than gold.
By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward.
Who can tell how often one offends? Cleanse me from my secret faults.
Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sin. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O God, my strength and my redeemer. Glory to God, our Creator, to God's most holy word, and to the Spirit indwelling us, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Galatians. Now before faith came, we were imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to the disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you are able as we sing the gradual.
There is one typo in the gradual. It is bringing peace, not bring peace. Bringing. I'll sing to begin.
Raise a song of gladness, people of the earth. Christ has come, bringing peace, joy to every heart. Alleluia, alleluia, joy to every heart. Alleluia, alleluia. Joy to every heart. Praise us.
and shouted at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." For Jesus had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man. For many times it had seized him. He was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles, but he would break the bounds and be driven by the demon into the wilds. Jesus then asked him, "What is your name?" He said, "Legion," for many demons had entered him. They begged him not to order them to go back into the abyss. Now there on the hillside, a large herd of swine was feeding, and the demons begged Jesus to let them enter these. So he gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the swine, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When the swineherd saw what had happened, they ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then people came out to see what had happened, and when they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. Those who had seen it told them how the one who had been possessed by demons had been healed. Then all the people of the surrounding country of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, for they were seized with great fear. So he got into the boat and returned. The man from whom the demons had gone begged that he might be with him, but Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." So he went away, proclaiming throughout the city how much Jesus had done for him. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. I speak to you in the name of the one who calls us into being, who walks with us on the journey, and who inspires us to transform ourselves and the world around.
Amen.
Amen.
As we just heard in the reading from St. Paul's letter to the church in Galatia, those who are baptized into Christ become one in Christ. Those things that divided them are removed. There is no longer Jew nor Greek. There is no longer slave nor free. There is no longer male nor female. All are one in Christ Jesus. Over the past couple of Sundays, and despite the diverse nature of this congregation, we have witnessed powerful evidence of this unity. On Pentecost Sunday, we heard the story of the visitation of the Holy Spirit shared in several languages. And last Sunday, together we celebrated baptism and confirmation of children and adults from various ethnic and cultural backgrounds. At the same time, Bishop John suggested that events in the world around us fail to reflect the similar unity. Whether we like it or not, whether we believe that we are one in Christ or not, we exist within a context of us and them, not unlike the first century world of Paul and Barnabas. Scenes that we humans are hardwired to view the world in dualistic terms. People, events, everything with which we come in contact must be this or that, but rather than this and that. Things are either good or bad, actions are right or wrong, people are friends or enemies. And today, as we celebrate National Indigenous Peoples Day, we might well take time to consider how thinking in these terms has impacted the lives of so many, not only in this country, but around the globe, for centuries. There's no longer an acceptance of a worldview that was expressed by Pope Nicholas V in the 15th century papal bull, which asserted that any lands not inhabited by Christians were deemed to be empty, unowned, and therefore available to be discovered and claimed. And yet, Now, over 5 centuries later, and despite many requests, there has been no formal repudiation or renunciation of that doctrine by the Vatican, though others, including the Anglican Church of Canada, have done so. And while I spend much of my time in territory where my Indigenous neighbors are no longer under the Indian Act, that's not true for the whole of Canada. And we're worshiping here today on land that remains unceded. An unfortunate incident, such as the arresting of a grandfather and his granddaughter as they tried to open a bank account, would clearly indicate that the mindset behind the doctrine of discovery lives on and undercuts the basic truth that Indigenous people are humans, entitled to both territorial and human rights. Most of us openly reject the policies and practices that introduced the residential school system and made Indigenous languages, cultural, and spiritual practices illegal. But there is still limited outcry regarding missing and murdered Indigenous girls and women, resource extraction without the free, prior, and informed consent of the Indigenous people of the land, and continued overrepresentation of Indigenous people in the child welfare and prison systems, including, as we recently learned, 2 sisters who have been in prison for 3 decades for a crime of which now most believe they are innocent. American public theologian Brian McLaren says that this has to do with the framing stories within each of us lives our lives. We all have a story that gives us direction, values, vision, and inspiration. A story that tells us who we are, where we come from, what the world is like, and how we should behave in the world as we see it. Sadly, many of the framing stories leave us blind to many ingrained and inherited sins. This blindness, says McLaren, has led to the structures of privilege which we tend to take for granted, and which makes so many oblivious to racism, gender discrimination, consumerism, environmental irresponsibility, nationalism, and denominational pride. And many of those framing stories are based on that dualistic belief that a world exists within the paradigm of this or that. Guys in the white hats and guys in the black hats. The story of Elijah, which we heard read to us, is a prime example. While we tend to think of Elijah in only positive terms, as prophet and miracle worker, pursued and persecuted by King Ahab and his wicked queen Jezebel, the reading began with the revelation that Elijah had just slaughtered all of the prophets of Baal. And similarly, our view of Queen Jezebel usually involves seeing her living down to her reputation as a promiscuous, manipulative, elitist, pagan harlot. But the truth is, Jezebel was a faithful follower of Ishtar, and she was never known to be promiscuous. In fact, if one were to check the genealogy of Jesus, one would find that Jezebel is one of the unnamed great-grandmothers. So the standard reference to Jesus as son of David, who, as we all know, despite his reputation for being good, did some very bad things, it could be revised to remind us that he's also a son of Jezebel. Shakespeare captured the errors of our ways when he wrote, "There is nothing either good or bad, but thinking makes it so." It is our thinking that causes us to make these judgments, to devalue and dehumanize others, those who do not appear like us, those who don't see or experience life as we do. But St. Paul says that to be true followers of Jesus, we must learn to move away from this way of viewing the world. We need to learn to be open, inclusive, and seek to engage with those things that the mind cannot begin to process. Infinity, mystery, God, grace, suffering, sexuality, love, and death. The gospel story is a prime example of what happens when we allow our thinking to devalue and dehumanize others. are told that the man who frequently ran about in the nude did not live in a house, but in the tombs, and that he was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles. An image is describing the way in which someone who hid out in the graveyard and thus was considered to be unclean was treated in first century Israel. Not that far removed from the way in which some of our mentally ill continue to be viewed in our contemporary society. Walk down any street in the city, and you're bound to be confronted, even accosted, by someone who's dealing with demons similar to those encountered by this man. And those who are not in the streets but are incarcerated or institutionalized are not always provided with the care that is needed to address the cause of their bizarre behavior. Still, it's important to acknowledge that to a greater or lesser degree, we all must deal with demons of one sort or another, be it depression, anxiety, obsession, addiction, or some other destructive habit. And when we allow ourselves to be separate from others and from normal living, we are giving power over to those demons. Zen teaching tells us that it takes desire and determination to free oneself from these demons. But both the Hebrew and the Christian scriptures teach us that in addition to desire and determination, we need divine help. In our darkest hours, we seek an encounter with God. Both this morning's reading from the Hebrew scriptures and the Gospel tell us about such encounters. In the story of Elijah, we learn that the nature of this encounter may not have been as anticipated. No earthquakes, no thunderbolts, no visions nor religious ecstasy, just that sheer silence and a small voice breaking through all the barriers that we put up around us, guiding us, teaching us, comforting us, healing us, and assuring us that all will be well. And the encounter with Jesus that we heard about in the Gospel tells about a profound transformation. Not only was the man healed and made whole, but he was commissioned to be an evangelist to his entire Gentile community. Despite his desire to go with Jesus, he obeyed when Jesus sent him away with this command: return to your home and declare how much God has done for you. And he did. And yet, despite the positive ending to the story, there remains one part that might well disturb us. We are told that when the people came out to see what had happened, they found the man from whom the demons had been gone, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed in his right mind, and they were afraid. Then they asked Jesus to leave them, for they were seized with great fear. Some have pointed to the death of the pace as the cause of the fear. But the people feared that Jesus' remaining there would be a blow to their economic well-being. But it seems to me that it is more likely that it is this evidence of divine power that frightens those who witness this profound transformation. The late Reformed theologian Robert Sproul said, "When the Holy One is manifest in the midst of unholy people, the only appropriate human response is dread." But it is not only unholy people who experience this dread. In addition to our tendency to see the world in terms of this or that, we also have a very deep desire to be in control. The people of Gennesaret asked Jesus to leave because he had taken control of the situation, and the result did not fit within their view of the world. And to them, this was a frightening thing. The man who had previously been ostracized clearly was like them. And that was frightening. But of course, that is the message given to us at Pentecost. The work of the Spirit is to bring together all those previously divided by language, ethnicity, culture, nationality, gender, class, and even levels of standing. All differences are reconciled in the kingdom of God. All are one. Jesus shows the people of Gennesaret and us what might happen. of our own making within which we desire to confine the divine mystery, fearful of what might happen when we relinquish a worldview based on what makes us different rather than how we are the same. Fearful of turning our lives over to the one who brings healing to us and to the world. Fearful that we might be called to go out and declare how much God has done for us. Let us pray. God, our refuge and hope, when race, status, or gender divide us, when despondency and despair haunt and afflict us, when community lies shattered, comfort and convict us with the stillness of your presence. Untie our burdens and heal our spirits. We lift up the prayers of our hearts for those still burdened, those seeking healing, those in need within the church and in the world. May it be so. Father, we gather today in memory of and to honor the First Nations and First Peoples of this land, your First Peoples. Throughout our prayer, we will remember how difficult their lives have been, the effect that other cultures have had on their culture, and how even today they struggle to have happy and fulfilling lives. We will also remember, either side on the love, those in our own lives that we care for and wish to bring their names forward. Amen. God the Creator, the strength of the people, we honor you. Listen to the thoughts of your people. We respect the truth of your spirit world and care for your creations to the east, to the south, to the west, and to the north. We honor you by deeds and not words. We live by the ways you have entrusted to us within the circle of life. Come, Great Spirit, as we gather in your name and say, come, Holy Creator Spirit. Come,
Holy Creator Spirit, come.
First, we face east. Oh, I'd actually ask you if you can stand and face the directions. First, we face east. To your symbol color gold, the breath of the morning sun. To your animal sign, the eagle, which soars ever upwards in praise of the Creator and calls us to do the same. To your words, calling us to balance our minds in the spirit of humanity and truth. We invoke your spirit of illumination and far-sighted vision. The ways have shown us how to love you and each other with heart, mind, and soul. And we pray, come.
Holy Spirit,
come. We turn to the south. To your symbol color red, the hue of revelation. To your animal sign, the wolf, strong and enduring. The ways call us to balance the spirit and harmony with all nations, tribes, and clans. We invoke your wisdom, grace, and goodness of the ages, and we pray.
Come.
Holy Creator Spirit,
come.
We turn to the west. To your symbol color black, the stillness of night. To your sign, thunder mighty and bold. To your animal sign, the buffalo. The ways call us to balance emotions in the tradition of truth and honesty. We invoke your spirit ways
calling us to balance of our body in the spirit of good sense and humor. We invoke your spirit of innocence, trust, and love, the ways open to our eyes. In the sacredness of each thing, and we pray, come.
Holy Spirit.
Come. We turn again to complete the circle, to God, the Creator, who cleanses the world of snow, wind, and rain, to the Creator's Son, Jesus the Christ, who fills us with mercy and loving embrace of all nations, and to the Holy Creator's Spirit, who guides us, and we pray, come.
Holy Creator Spirit, come.
Please be seated and take a moment in your own mind and hearts to remember those whose names you wish to bring forward today. Creator, you bent the earth like a bow until it was one round, shining planet. At your word, the land was drawn into the mountains and tundra, forests and prairies. The waters were gathered together into rivers, lakes, and seas. Many times when people crossed these seas from other lands, they broke the circle of your creation by their greed and violence, and they shattered the lives of others. Creator, renew the circle of the earth and turn the hearts of all people to one another, that they and all the earth may live and be drawn towards you. Through the love of Jesus Christ, who lives with you and the Holy Spirit, in the circle of the Trinity, forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now for something different than we usually do, I've adapted part of the apology by Archbishop Primate Michael Pierce that he made to the Indigenous Peoples Gathering in 1993, so 29 years ago. I adapted this knowing that we in our own hearts perhaps think it wasn't our fault. It wasn't us who did it. And that's true. I'm sure I know each one of you in your hearts, and I know the goodness and love that resides there. So what we're doing is engaging with collective sin, not personal sin. It's not that Patty did this and Bruce did that and Martha did this. It's that we as a community, we as a human people, and sadly, we as a church have committed this collective sin. It's complicated and it takes lots of work to unpack it, to understand it, to begin to walk again. I thank Jeanette for the work that she's done both today and in the past as we've tried to engage in some of the complicated issues of this process. But I thought if we said this together, if we prayed it in our hearts, it is part of the healing process. And I've included for you to take home and look at later the entire message from Archbishop Michael Pierce. But let us join today with our national church and say, we are deeply conscious of the sacredness of the stories that have been told, and we hold in the highest honor those who have told them. We have heard with admiration the stories of people and communities who have worked at healing and are aware of how much healing is needed. We also know that we are in need of healing, and all people are in need of healing, and our church is in need of healing. Without that healing, we will continue the same attitudes that have done such damage in the past. We also know that healing takes a long time, both for people and for communities. We also know that it is God who heals, and that God can begin to heal when we open ourselves, our wounds, our failures, and our shame to God. we confess before God and you our failures in the residential schools. We failed you. We failed ourselves. We failed God. We are sorry, more than we can say, that we were part of a system which took children from home and family. We are sorry, more than we can say, that we tried to remake you in our image, taking from you your language and the signs of your identity. We are sorry, more than we can say, that in Anglican schools so many were abused physically, sexually, culturally, and emotionally. On behalf of the Anglican Church of Canada, we present our apology. And so, beloved friends, let us draw this confession into our hearts and into our beings, knowing that it is God who heals, and that God will heal us when we open ourselves, our wounds, our failures, and our shame to this ever-loving God. In this process, we will all find forgiveness. Amen. Please stand as you are able. Beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, may the peace of the risen Christ be with you all. And also with you. Let us share a sign of that peace with one another. God's peace. God's peace. Paz del Señor. Patty will teach us our offertory song, Come, Come.
I'll sing it first.
Come, come, come to the table in love. We come together in Jesus' name. We come to the table. Come, come, come to the table in love. We come together in Jesus' name. We come to the table in love.
We come in need.
Come, come, come to the table.
We praise you at a time when the body of earth is broken again. again and again. We give thanks for our place in the story of salvation. Our ancestors journeyed with you in creation and migration. They depended on the land, were displaced from the land, and displaced others from their lands. They knew you in tents and cities, on mountains and by wells, in families and in dreams, and through wilderness prophets who spoke of cedars and listened to ravens. Together with angels and ancestors, Orca and Seven, Bear and Raven, Salal and Cedar, we join our voices with all creation in this ancient honor song.
Holy, 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 God of power and might. Holy, 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 God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Blessed is the one who comes in.
Again, after supper, he took the cup of wine, fruit of the land, gave thanks, and gave it to his friends, saying, "Drink this. This is my blood, which is shed for you. Whenever you do this, you do it in memory of me." Remembering Jesus' life, death and resurrection, and awaiting his coming kingdom, we offer you this bread and this cup. Creator, send your spirit on these gifts so that we who know Jesus in them will be gathered together with everyone who shares this sacred meal of justice and community. Fill us with the courage and love of Jesus, that we may strive for justice and peace, respecting the dignity of every human being and safeguarding the integrity of creation. Bring us with Saint Barnabas and all the saints to the commonwealth of sparrow and lily, child and beggar, which is both now and yet to come. All honor and glory are yours, Creator and Christ, with the Holy Spirit, now and forever. And now let us pray as our Savior taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Creator of all, you gave us golden fields of wheat, whose many grains we have gathered and made into this one bread. So may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your reign of justice and peace. These are the gifts of God, and we are the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I'll invite you, as we have been doing, to come forward, and we'll tradition now says, we'll start on the right and go to the left, and invite everyone who wishes to come for Holy Communion. Musician can go first, and if you wish only to receive the bread, that you're welcome.
Oh, dear.
announcements. Today, we will hopefully have our first dry sacred singing circle out in the courtyard. So if you are able to come back and sing with us at 4, we are going to shake the cherry trees, I hope.
Dry as in no rain.
Dry. And also no beverages that would make it not dry. But everyone is welcome. So please come back to church if you're able. And it will be a wonderful gathering. Also, we are continuing now. Next week will be our fourth Thursday of our Drawing a Circle of Love. It's a family drop-in, and we've been blessed to have Veronique come, and Edie's Iris has come with her little girls. And so next Thursday at 10 o'clock, jueves a las 10, at 10 o'clock, it was just so wonderful to have our neighbors come. We're also always looking for more volunteers. If anyone wants to come and hang out with little ones, it's been really wonderful. Thank you, Martha, for helping carry it forward as Jessica has been sick. Jessica's now back in the saddle, so we're really excited to carry on with that program. And now Martha has an even more exciting announcement.
So as we talked about before, we're trying to get our weekly kind of lunch gathering time going again since the days of the pandemic when it was suspended. So we have a little group had a meeting a week or so ago, and we decided that we want to call it Love, Listen and Love, Saturday Afternoon Cafe. And so we thought we'll give it a trial all the Saturdays in July and August. We'll meet out in the courtyard, we'll have some light snacks, some tables up with maybe some card games or board games, an English practice table, just a time to spend some time together. So if you're interested in helping out, please let us know. And if you want to come, please, everyone is welcome. Bring your friends. Hopefully all the Saturdays in July and August, the weather will be good. And we'll have some time together outside. Enjoy a little bit of light food. Nothing too complicated. So that's Listen and Love, Saturday afternoons from 2 to 4 through July and August for now. And we'll see how that goes and revisit and rejig and then moving forward into the fall.
So that starts, is it July 2nd?
July 2nd. Yes. July 2nd is the first Saturday. Yeah.
Wonderful. Good. Thank you. Thank you so much.
I have a crafts commercial announcement.
Oh, please.
Our custodian, Jay Barton Seahouse, is a guest singer with the Vancouver Children's Choir.
What?
Next Sunday at Christchurch Cathedral at 3 p.m.
Oh.
I have some tickets, and it's by donation. It's not a set fee, it's whatever you can afford. And I invite you to see me out to coffee time and get a ticket.
That's a wonderful announcement. They're a wonderful choir. Choir. And Jade, I had no idea. How lovely, wonderful. We'll see who we can round up to go to that. So let us join with Patty and with all our relations as we sing this song. Please stand as you are able.
Don't worry about getting in front of me. Don't worry. We'll see how much we've got in our heads still.
Thank you. sign.
We are going to put around a sign-up sheet to help those two out. They've been holding that together for since we've been allowed to come back, and it would be nice if we took turns in that department as well. So maybe we'll even get that going today.